up, everybody? It's Joe La Puma. You were listening. You were watching the Complex Sneakers podcast. As always, I am with my guys. First, to my right, Mr. Matt Welty.
It's like the first mile of a marathon today, right?
Yeah, you guys got a busy day.
Yep.
But I'm glad that you got a new haircut for it. Look, that's a different hairstyle. That's a different one. That's a different one than you're used to. A lot of hair comments always week to week about you, but that's a different haircut.
Is that right? Are they in the YouTube comments?
But Welty, isn't that a little different?
Yeah, I went
high and tight?
I went in
skin fade?
I went in it'd been about 2 years, but finally made a trip back to see the Russian barber.
Looks different. Looks good. Sorry. looks different. Looks good. To my left, of course, Mr. Brendan Dunne.
Here I am.
How you doing?
I'm all right. I feel like it's been a long time since we had just the three of us. Is that right?
Yes, it's been weeks and weeks.
I know people like that. I like when we bring other people in, but we're just going to hang out today. We're just going to chop it up amongst ourselves.
Exactly. That's what we do best, right?
Also, I feel like on one hand, I don't want to be redundant, you know, and like there's a lot of episodes where at the top we're like, oh, it's a busy day. But you know what? That's just our lives.
Today's been that's what we got.
It's reality.
That's what you guys got to that's what we all got to realize. Oh, busy day. Every day's busy.
Yes.
And you guys got a lot going on today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I just got back from a trip to Mexico. So, you know, it was a good time.
We both got back from trips. How was Mexico?
We got to talk about both of these.
You go
trips.
First.
Mexico was a good time. I was down there for the House of Vans opening.
Okay.
Talked to Steve Van Doren for a while. Ran around eating tacos. You know, my Spanish is not as good as it used to be.
Okay.
So I am thankful to my friend Nick from Hypebeast who helped me out a little bit, and he speaks Spanish quite well.
You made friends on the trip.
Yeah.
Who
else? So we were rolling around.
Okay.
It was. Yeah. I was happy about that.
All right. Look at that. Sneaker media bringing people together.
You
love
know,
it.
I caught the end of the F1. Season finale in the airport. I was hectically, you know, shuffling all my passports and attestation forms and vaccine proofs while I was streaming on a bootleg thing.
The controversial end, right?
Controversial for sure. Shout out to all my F1 fans out there.
The real question is, so no sunburn. So what SPF did you use?
None.
Was the weather nice?
The weather was nice, but I was also inside in the hotel room working quite a bit while I was down here in Mexico.
Complex Sneakers podcast where you were in warm weather climate. I went to Aspen with the Kith trip. Cold weather climate.
Yeah, and you know what? Welty, did you notice the photos for the Kith trip?
Yeah, Joe wasn't on the slopes.
I saw so many. I saw
I know that you DM'd. I know that you DM'd Ronnie something. I was on the slopes. I have proof.
Wait.
Go ahead.
Were you on the? I thought you were on the slopes with skis or a snowboard, or on the slopes with the snowmobile.
You had a sled.
Snowmobile.
How did you know that I DM'd Ronnie?
He told me.
Is that a slope? If you're on a snowmobile, that's more of like on the base.
It was a trail. Yeah. It was a trail. Okay. I was out there for 4 hours in nature. I have the picture. I sent you guys the pictures to prove it.
You didn't reenact the Pine Barrens episode?
No.
I get that.
It's funny. That's funny.
By the way, I get that one.
Went snowmobiling for 3 to 4 hours. Great trip.
Like I said, though, I was let down because I see Nunez on the ski lift.
Heavy. They were all heavy on it.
Maybe 13th Witness.
Chris Stamp. 13th Witness wasn't there. Chris Stamp is like a real snowboarder. You saw the photos.
I see Daniel Arsham bombing the half pipe or something.
Arsham.
But I see the photo of Joe. It's just you on like a little trail with maybe some trees around it.
Wasn't even a trail.
A dusting of snow.
It wasn't
just
even
posing. You.
It wasn't a trail.
You're in Aspen and you didn't do any snow activities like that.
I went snowmobiling. Listen, it wasn't even a trail. It was like, all right, relax.
No, I just got the, when you mentioned Daniel Arsham, hitting the half pipe, just in my head, I'm envisioning him having like a long history in like Norwegian, like cross country skiing.
They're all very good. My shot was not even on a trail. It was like a tree outside the hotel into town.
You were leaned up when you had
the money shot.
You
from
had
the Kith fit.
What do you call that style of jacket that you had on?
Reversible. Plaid.
Don't look at me. I don't know.
Oh no, it was like the
puffer,
like the Japanese style jacket.
I don't know the name for that.
I'm not sure.
I'm sorry.
Great trip. Something that came up. You guys got props on the trip. Someone said, "Oh man, the show with the three guys."
The three guys.
No, not the three guys.
They didn't know our name.
No, not that. I shouldn't say that. The show on Complex. They were saying, you know what they said was the funniest episode though. Which, what do you think it is?
Premium Pete.
No.
What?
Go back in the archives. They're like, one of the funniest things I've watched was this episode of Full Size Run. What was it?
Oh, Full Size Run? Oh, I have no idea. I mean, they're all hits.
Jim Jones?
No.
Yeezy Busta?
Come on, two more guesses.
Fat Joe?
No.
Marcus Jordan?
No, good internet, maybe not your favorite.
Oh, Rich the Kid.
Yes.
Oh.
I always love when we get props for that one.
Yeah. I mean, that's the thing. That's how it goes. You get props for it. But yeah, it was good internet, and they said it was one of the funniest things.
I'll take that.
Great trip.
Wait, can I talk about my trip a little bit more?
Yeah, of course. I'm sorry.
There is a... No, I mean...
Okay.
No. You don't need to apologize.
Okay.
One funny thing, and I tweeted about this. I hope y'all saw it. I was at this sneaker store in Mexico City, and I saw this mural. Did you see this, Walter?
No, I didn't see it. No.
I saw it.
It is the most absurd thing I've ever seen. So in this sneaker store, which they have like a cereal bar in the sneaker store.
Is this like a resale shop or a retail shop?
No, a retail shop.
Okay.
In the back, they have a basketball court, and there's a mural painted on this basketball court. It's on the wall.
Mm-hmm.
And the group of people in this mural... So there's Jerry Lorenzo, Justin Bieber, Basquiat, Virgil Abloh, Karl Lagerfeld, Jonah Hill. I'm going to text you a photo of this real quick, Welty. Ray Kawakubo is on there. Homeo from Atmos is on there. Jun Takahashi. It's just the most absurd collection of characters that you could ever imagine. Beyonce, Travis Scott, Jeff Staple.
Did you sign it?
I was actually peeling back. I'm texting it to you now, Welty. Peeling back some of the covering to see if maybe my face was up there. Bad Bunny, you from Ambush. Just
classic. I was like,
what do these people have to do with each other? The woman from Die Antwoord, the South African rap group, is on there. Do you see it now, Welty?
It's also like funny because, you know, the people who are going in there, and it's like, unless you're like super like insider baseball, it's like, how many people are going to recognize, like, oh, that's Homeo?
Homeo is the most absurd inclusion, which he's a legend in sneakers, but nobody's ever going to know. And also, he's right by Jonah Hill. Like, what type of sense does that make?
Joe, speaking of going in the archives, maybe I'm mistaking things. Is this the hoodie that you wore on the original sneaker shopping episode?
Let's check.
Wow.
And it is.
Wow.
And it is.
This dude's memory. Wow.
This is
the first ever sneaker shopping
with
episode?
With Jim Jones.
Hoodie? Yes. Let's see if the internet works here.
Do you think you could maybe we could partner with eBay to auction that off as like a charity thing?
April 5th, 2011. This guy's right.
Joe,
I didn't even think about it. Yeah, April 5th, 2011. I've had this
10 years
hoodie, and that's what I love about Supreme. You keep them, and like.
So is this hoodie gonna get hung up in the Smithsonian,
or the new BuzzFeed office,
or do you think it could be like put in the rafters at Flight Club?
Where would you rather see it? Either would be apropos.
Maybe we put it over here.
Yeah.
Put it over here, maybe?
Maybe after another 10 years.
Not a store.
What sneakers were you wearing again? I don't remember.
Bordeaux 7s.
Wow. History right
and
there.
And you know how I remember? Because he goes, you have a, you know, you're more of a Wiz Khalifa jeans type of, Jim says that. Because my jeans were tighter.
The Wiz Khalifa jeans.
Yeah, because I was wearing the tight jeans. Bordeaux 7s, this hoodie. Yeah, good memory.
When was the last time you watched that?
A while ago.
Never, right? I would never go back and watch the old stuff unless I absolutely had to.
Very, very stiff as a host.
We've come a long way.
We have come a long way.
We're famous. One person.
Recognize you?
Recognized me in Mexico City, but it was the funniest encounter because we hopped out of the Sprinter van, and I wasn't sure if he was just asking for a photo with me because I seemed like somebody because I was coming out of a Sprinter van, because he didn't say anything to me. He just pointed at me and like lifted his finger and like made a hand signal like he wanted a photo. And I was like,
I've been doing a lot of this.
You've been hanging, you were throwing the shakas?
Yeah.
Hanging loose?
Yeah.
In the photos?
How do we feel about that as a...
Oh, man. I'm living Akamai every day.
It's like...
Shout out to the 808. I'm with you.
You're walking past and it's like, you know...
Yeah,
I like
Shaka.
This seems a little more warmth as a, you know, not stop, like, you're walking past someone.
Switching it up a little bit.
Yeah, what do you do?
He's a big peace sign guy.
Peace sign guy. If I'm feeling a little spicy, it might be like the pretending like we're getting ready for a big fight and throwing like the fist.
Ooh, okay.
You know?
Okay, well.
I'll do a thumbs up. I'm trying to do the J
thumbs
Prince.
Up is
I'm
cool.
trying to do the J Prince with the one hand in the pocket and the pointing. I might steal that.
Yeah, like this. That's what.
But sorry, this guy asked for the photo and he didn't say anything. And I was like, I have no idea if this person knows who I am. And then 3 days later, he tagged me on an Instagram story being like, I took a photo with this guy. Do you guys think this is Brendan Dunne or not?
They don't wow. expect you to be in different places.
Well, I mean, worldwide. If you're in Mexico City, it's kind of like...
You go to the kebab spot in Jersey, you expect to see him there. Mexico City? Not sure.
That was the only one, though. Nobody at the Adidas store recognized me. That's a little, right. little disappointing. Adidas store, I saw... Have you guys seen the Pharrell... Human Made, the latest round of Adidas apparel. This is super random, but I quite like that stuff.
There's the one Speedy wore at the NASDAQ?
No, I don't think so. There's like a brown short set, and there's a blue top that's kind of like the Aqua ZX8000.
Okay.
I like that all stuff. Right.
I'll check it out.
You might see me in that.
Your cosign.
It means a lot to you?
Definitely. Some sneaker news.
Artifact?
Yeah, Nike acquiring.
NFT company.
The NFT company. Are we getting left behind?
Left behind what? Because we're not into the sneaker NFTs?
No, because I don't own one.
Welty? I know Welty is. Welty has many strong.
I don't even want to get into it, and I don't want people to be in my. I don't even want to get into it.
I need an hour sit down with Fran Alations next time he's in New York. Okay.
So he can convince you on like multi level like marketing or something.
No,
like that?
He will bring me up to speed. Bobby Hundreds did great on our podcast. I learned a lot. Mm-hmm. Next step, Fran Alations, we go to the Mercer Hotel, we have some tea, and he schools me on it. He's all over it.
I do agree with both. You got to be careful if you mention anything NFT related on social media, because people immediately want to chime in or tell you why your opinion is wrong or something like that. So I totally understand.
There's like a lot of things that they're like, oh, and I won't get into it, but it's like a lot of things that people, you know, they'll tell you like, oh, you're not looking out for your future or whatever by not investing in this. And there's like, I'm like, there's a lot of things you're not doing that are probably good for your future that you're not doing right now, and we're not going to talk about it.
Yeah, like you could easily tell them they were not at the CrossFit box at 7 a.m. this morning, but you're not out here criticizing them.
Exactly. I'm not even bringing it up to them. So let's not have a discussion.
Okay. Speaking about some Twitter conversation, I was immersed in wrestling Twitter yesterday.
Oh, okay. Gosh.
For the Young Bucks saying that they started sneakers, even though in the episode they basically say they give it up to Shane McMahon. But
Shane O'Mac.
You know, Kofi Kingston has been doing sneakers for a while. He's been on both of our shows.
Yes.
But yeah, wrestling Twitter was going back and
forth. Our guy Mosh chimed in on
Mosh,
the... Yeah.
What did Mosh have to say?
Mosh, I think that Mosh's point was like, anytime you say you did it first, you have to be careful.
I think his quote was, these guys are crazy, LOL.
Yeah. But yeah, there was wrestlers
Joe
before.
Joe was serve up the safer version.
Yeah, I mean, I paraphrase. But yeah, wrestling Twitter was definitely talking about that. And
that's
and
weird. I didn't see it.
Really?
Yeah, wrestling Twitter not
wrestling
really.
Twitter not in that crossover.
Really show up on my timeline.
Yeah. So Young Bucks episode in between seasons is out now. Go check that out. They talk about a bunch of stuff.
You pressed them on it though.
I did.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. You pressed.
Oh,
them.
What people said that their Dior Jordans were fake.
No, well, that's in it. But
you brought that up too, and they claim that they're not. Which I think we all agree that they are.
They kind of left the door open, right?
They left the door open, yeah.
They kind of said if they are fake, it
but
makes sense.
But they definitely have real ones.
The
they definitely have real ones.
Yeah.
The issue is if they wrestled in the real ones,
which
I think they're leaving it open-ended.
I think, remember when it came out, a lot of people were saying the swoosh looked a little funny on that.
That's what I said in the episode. People were like, you know, looking at it. But Matt, one of the brothers, got the Dior ones.
What are they called? The Rowdy Boys? The Young Guns? What are they called?
The Young Bucks.
Young Bucks.
One of the...
There's only one Young Buck I acknowledge.
I know.
He's straight out of Cashville. Yes. Sorry, go on.
Tenneke, right?
Yes, sir.
I mean, who would you be more excited to have? I mean, you had those guys on Secret Shopping, but if you had to pick between the Young Bucks and Young Buck...
Not even going to acknowledge it.
So
not even
they do have they have real Dior ones though, because the wife got it from Matt Jackson, the Dior one Lowe's, and one of them got stolen. If you watch the episode,
I
obviously know you guys watch the episode because you help out, and I appreciate it.
So when is Young Buck coming on?
That's what I'm saying. Big G,
you would
fan?
Have Young Buck on full size one,
of course.
Yeah, as long as he brings the spinner chain
and the
G Unit
sneakers.
The mic tour,
Young
I threw
Buck,
out
G-Unit
my chain.
Young Buck was a little after G Unit sneakers, right?
Well, he joined the group though, like after the first. But he was on the album, right?
Yeah, so maybe he has them.
Man, I love that first Young Buck album.
All right, guys, you know what time it is. We got to give away some sneakers from eBay.
That's right.
To one lucky listener.
That's right.
What do we got?
We actually don't even... You know what? I saw this box that we're giving away, and I wasn't sure what sneakers were in it. Now I think I have an idea what shoes are in it.
I took a peek.
So did I.
You know, y'all know what... Okay. Before we open up the box, let's discuss how you get the pair of sneakers. Every week...
Hit them with it. Every
this
week.
This is how it works.
Are they listening every week, or are they not?
I always want to remind people. How many weeks in? On the Complex Sneakers podcast, we give away a free pair of shoes with eBay every week. You can go to ebay.complex.com and submit a question to ask us. If we pick your question and we answer your question here on the air, we're going to send you a free pair of sneakers. It's only open to U.S. residents, so please keep that in mind when you submit. This week, we did pick a question from Raymond Solis from Laredo, Texas, who asked, what is your opinion on restoring your sneakers if your midsole is cracking or the paint is cracking, something is falling apart in the shoe? So that's what Raymond has asked. We're going to give Raymond a free pair of sneakers. Can I show the sneakers Raymond's getting?
From a former guest.
Yep.
Sick.
Get the reaction. That's the reaction. Yeah. When you open a pair, when you open a box, that's the reaction you want.
Woo! And this is an apropos sneaker. Stash Nike Air Force One.
For the stash?
Yeah. Okay. A shoe that may need some restoring sooner or later, although...
Look at that
you
shoe.
You know, Air Force Ones from this era, it's still holding up reasonably well. I think we might have to ask our friends like Abdul Clark.
I feel like that fits with your color palette as well.
Yeah, eBay authenticity
that
guarantee
would look great
tag
right
on
now.
There. You think I should throw them on? No, these are for Raymond. These are for Raymond.
Jeez.
Okay. Right. So Raymond has asked, what is your opinion on restoring your sneakers? Raymond's getting this pair of Stash Air Force Ones. How do we feel about putting shoes back together again? No Humpty Dumpty.
This is timely for me because I think I definitely said on this podcast, the Slam City Skates, at Nike Dunk SB.
Fell apart,
the toe box, but it was very weird, like almost like a tar-like.
Sorry, they didn't fall apart, right? Like...
They crumbled, but just
on the toe, right?
Yeah, the toe box. It was some material that like it wasn't as documented as other like the soles fall apart or the air bubbles cloudy. It was like this weird, the toe box like it was like a tar type
rubber
of
peeling off.
And I only wore them once and I got them, I think. Two summers ago or
what year is Slam City Dunk from? 2006 or older?
No, like 2005, I believe.
2005, okay.
So basically, I was like, what am I going to do? I talked to you guys. I was like, listen, they're not wearable. I would put them on to try them on my apartment. The tar or whatever it was would get all over the apartment. I was like, I'm going to have to throw them out. Matt from corporate, shout to Matt.
Corporate got him.
Said, hit up this guy. He restores sneakers, and he just did the Slam City Skates recently. His Instagram, I got to shout him out, Kicks to Chris.
Okay.
I sent it to him. California, they came out great. They came out great.
Like new? Or he just peeled the rest of the stuff off? Or what
did
he do?
No, I don't know the process. I'll leave it up to him. But it was a process of a few weeks. I'm going to put a picture of how good they look in here. And it made me a real believer.
Is that the first time you've ever had a shoe restored or like brought back to life like that in a way?
Yeah, and I appreciate the work. And like, I even, the toe box was all messed up with the material seeping on the suede toe box. He cleaned it up. He cleaned up the problem area, and some of the best money I've spent in getting them restored.
Welty, I think you and I have had conversations about this before. Yeah. How do you feel about restoring a pair of sneakers?
I think it's a case-by-case basis. Mm-hmm. Like, being a guy who's into running shoes, obviously have, like, a lot of friends that, like, a lot of, like, the Grail-level Air Maxes, you just can't wear them anymore.
Yeah.
So, like, maybe, like... you know, an OG like Atmos Air Max 1, you can't wear it. So a lot of people think it's like best to sole swap it, which I think is the right move if you really want to wear one of those. There's like some stuff I've seen where like people have had like OG sample Air Max 95s. And I'm like, and they're like, oh, you can sole swap this. And I'm like, this shoe's like a piece of history.
Yeah.
So, yeah, like stuff like that, it's like, I don't know.
I know what you mean. It almost like takes away from the integrity of the object if you replace
it. It's like if you had a pair of OG Jordan 4s, like 1989s, you're not going to soul swap those so you can wear them around. You should just kind of like keep it intact.
That's
like
how I feel.
I agree with that. Yeah. Even PG has been, shout out PG.
It was his birthday.
When? Yep.
on
yesterday, right?
Yesterday.
Yeah.
Happy belated PG.
I told him for his birthday I'm inviting him on the podcast.
He has to come on. We've been through that. But PG has been posting to like either 85 or a 94 Jordan 1. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a soul swap. And it's a little different.
I don't want to buy, if I'm buying an OG sneaker and it's soul swap, it's just not the same to me. So I can understand people wanting to extend the life of their sneakers by replacing some parts or things like that. And I don't know if there's a taboo around it in car culture, which is kind of similar in terms of, you know, making old things new again. But for me, I don't really mind the wear that's accrued on a pair through years of it actually existing in the real world. And like I said, like, I don't want to own a 1985 Jordan 1 if the sole is from a 2015 Jordan 1.
Well, it's kind of like, you know, you always see on those like antique road shows. Mm-hmm. Sort of thing where like someone had like an original lamp from like 1912, but they're like, oh, but it's not worth anything because someone like refurbished it.
Oh, I see.
Yeah,
I see.
Definitely.
So that's how we feel about this. Let us know in the comments how you feel about it. I would say
to the 1985 Jordan 1s I wore them for the Shaq finale. Yeah. And I hit up Curated Van. I was like, hey, do these have an hour or two in them? And he's like, you'll be fine.
Oh, yeah.
But I was like, sliding all over the store. It reminded me of like the Hender scheme sole.
Yeah. Or because I think I've said it on here before, the pair of 1985 Jordan 1s, I have the traction on the bottom is totally gone. So same type of thing where you can just, you can move.
Wait, you have a what?
Quite well in them. Pair of 1985 black and red Jordan 1s.
Really?
They're quite beat.
Yeah.
Oh, you should bring those out though.
I thought you brought them to the, I think you brought them to the office when we had shot that.
Comparison.
Yeah, it was like, versions. We had done it years ago where we like, it was like for the Bread re-release in like 2015 or whatever. We had shot every single Bread one, and I think we had used your pair for
For sure.
And you're right, though. On Pawn Stars, they're always like, this is an original, and you're about to get a lot of money, and then someone comes in, and they're like, no, this has been swapped out or something.
Yep.
Great show. That's a great show.
Yeah, sorry. Zach the Basic is texting me right now.
That's okay.
We always have time for Zach.
Speaking of Pawn Stars...
Chumlee?
OG...
Sneaker shopping.
OG sneaker shopping alum, Chumlee.
I just texted Zach back and told him we're shooting right now.
So. Tell Zach I said hello.
Well, he'll hear that because we're keeping this in, so...
And I always have time for him.
I have time for him. I texted him back in the middle of a shoot.
Fair. You know who I'm talking to right now?
Tell me.
Lorenz, because I'm getting another.
Lorenz OG?
Yeah.
Okay.
Stay tuned. All right. Should we get into...
Our topic.
It's just the three of us.
It's a big one.
It's a big one. Look at the date. The date is December 17th. That's when this is going to run. It's really December 14th. We're on YouTube, though. So this is showbiz. So it's really December 17th. So we are at the end of the year, which means end of the year list.
Mm-hmm.
Best sneakers of 2021. We didn't get to do it at ComplexCon this year. We're doing it right now with you guys.
Yeah.
Our team has come up with the list.
Yep.
We're going to talk about the list. Going to interject. I'm sure that there's some shoes that didn't make the compiled list that we love.
Yeah.
Let's go through it.
And there's personal picks we have. This is not our personal favorite shoes of the year. You know, it's and I'd love to talk about the criteria because every time we put out one of these lists, which we do a lot of them, it's always, how did you determine these things or how did you determine what the best shoes of the year are? Our general approach is to have something that reflects the tastes of our audience, but also our own tastes. It's not about the most resellable sneakers or the most expensive sneakers. We have a separate list from that. It's kind of which sneakers felt like the biggest ones in our scene over the course of the year, and which ones were also the best. And somewhere between that. Not a black and white dunk that sold a million pairs, but the most interesting ones.
Sounds like sneaker of the year?
No.
It didn't make the list.
That's not.
And again, this is a composite of all the opinions of the people who work on Complex sneakers. So we do argue these things in depth. So if there are certain entries that we don't agree with on an individual level, it's because as the group.
How long did it take to debate? I wasn't on the Zoom, but I'm looking at this list.
I actually had this.
Pretty good, man.
I had a precarious situation because remember it was like 5:45 and you're like, you guys want to talk sneakers of the year or whatever? And I was like.
You had a meeting for the superintendent?
No, but I was like, well, I had to actually do something. I was like. It was like end of the day, sure. And I was like, yes, I have 20 minutes. I have like a hard out. Like I actually had to like take care of a superintendent.
I knew.
No.
There was a leak on the fourth floor?
And then like literally as like the 20th minute hit, my Zoom call dropped and I was like, that's a sign that...
Gotta go sleep the hallway. Okay.
Let's do it.
Can we? I want to talk first about some of the stuff that didn't make it.
Yeah, like from... Yes, sorry.
Okay.
I have one that...
Tell me.
The Jown 990 V4, navy blue.
There's one shoe that...
I really like that shoe.
It just wasn't interesting enough to me.
I have the number 10 shoe on this list, and I really like the number 10 shoe, but I think... that I like the Jound a little better.
The
Jound
New Balance stuff this year didn't feel like a big deal. I feel like it came and went, and the colorways were not that special to me. Welty, what were you
going
to
say?
I've long resigned myself from knowing the shoes that I like aren't going to be the top 10.
That's fair. I'm just saying from my personal.
Yeah. But there's one shoe that maybe if that whole situation didn't occur, I felt like I would have argued a lot more for. On the list that didn't make the list.
Okay. Which one?
Which is, I think the, I know there's already two other Virgil shoes on the list, so maybe that's like saturation or whatever, but I do think that yellow Virgil Air Force One good is one. Much more important than another shoe that's on the list.
Really?
The yellow Virgil Air Force One, the ICA one, that one was close to making the cut. I guess we just felt like it was kind of a sequel sneaker in a way. And a lot of times we don't give as much weight to those shoes that are the same idea, just executed again. So I did think that was a cool release.
I like that one a lot.
I think we're valuing Virgil sneakers a lot right now because of his recent passing. But I do feel like it would have been too many off-white Nike sneakers on the list if we had included that one. But it was quite close. And I think that's a beautiful shoe.
Same.
Another one, Supreme Dunks. We didn't put
those
on here.
Wait, so the Supreme Dunks were high on our 2021 so far list. And they're not on this one.
I mean, to me, that's another like sequel type shoe where it's just like it's the same old idea, but transfer it to a low and just wasn't that exciting.
Here's what I want to say. I don't want to jump ahead, but no, I do think lot 50 of the off-white is better than the Supreme Dunks.
Yeah, for sure.
Do you guys think
that? Yeah.
The black and silver?
Yeah. And lot one.
And lot
one is better than lot 50.
Really?
By far.
Well, I mean, obviously, you're not going to agree with that because the white is the lot one, right?
Yeah.
So why should we wait?
Yeah, we'll
okay,
wait.
Okay, we'll get back. All right, let's go. Number 10.
Wait. Can we talk about a couple more that didn't make the list?
So, what for me,
What the P-Rod didn't make the list, which I don't think it was anywhere close to making the list, but I know some people like that shoe.
I think that shoe.
This year, too, it's like Dunks almost like eliminated themselves. Because there's so many of them where it's like, oh, like obviously there's a Dunk that's going to make the list, but like Nike really like didn't do the Dunk any favors as far as like.
I mean, it did favors as a mainstream shoe.
Like, yeah, no, I know, definitely but a mainstream shoe, but also like, accessible. But like burning it out in a year, you know.
What I like about this year is that, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm looking at it. Our 2021 so far list that we did, around June, looks a lot different than this list.
Good, yeah.
And I think that's good. Like a lot of years.
Sometimes we debate as to whether or not we can go back and change those opinions, but I think the way a sneaker looks 6 months later does change.
Yeah.
One more shoe I want to mention that I felt should have made the cut but didn't is the Salehe Bembury Crocs.
Okay. Do you have those?
I don't have those.
Okay.
But it's a Croc.
It is a Croc, but... Salehe Bembury did so much in sneakers this year, and we don't have any of his shoes on the list. And I think that Croc is the coolest one and the most interesting one and the best one of them.
But it's not a sneaker.
That's the thing. People were arguing against me that it's not a sneaker, but we put the Foam Runner on the year-end list last year. Mm, and to me, the Foam Runner is just as much a sneaker as the Salehe Croc.
I can't imagine how all over those are going to be. If you have the Salehe Crocs during the holiday season, perfect. Chill shoe.
Yeah, so I'll go on record saying I wanted the Salehe Croc, but another one that made just was on the bubble. Didn't quite make it.
I'm also putting, I know that it's not like a new silhouette, but I'm putting the Salomon XT4 tie-dye.
Just personally for you. Yeah.
Yep.
Anything else, Welty, before we get into the proper list that you want to mention?
Well, I think I already said that my personal favorite shoe, which I do not own, which is very similar to this, ALD 993s.
No, they look good in Aspen, I'll tell you that. I don't have them, but someone was wearing...
Black midsole, the black else. It's not right. But
I look good.
But I respect your opinion. Okay, Joe, you want to kick us off the number 10 sneaker of the year on
number
our list?
Before we get to that, real quick, some housekeeping. What are we wearing today before we get into the list?
Sorry. We should talk about that. I have these Mephisto Concepts sneakers on. I'm pretty sure I wore these on this podcast before. I wear these a lot right now. It's a shoe I'm most frequently wearing right now, probably.
Yeah, just wearing these GR 990 V4s from like 4 years ago.
Which is basically the same thing as the Jown shoe that you just
mentioned. No,
the
ALD.
Oh, sorry, the ALD shoe.
Yeah, very, very.
We asking Santa for the ALD for Christmas?
I don't like asking anyone to get me sneakers. for Fair. Christmas.
Not Fair. Even Santa Claus?
Or even like a birthday.
My it's mom just... asked, what do I want for Christmas? I said, Dick's Sporting Goods crew socks, the best.
Really?
Yeah, really good.
Okay. What do you got on, Joe?
Classic hoodie that my colleague pointed out.
He's going to do the Trinidad thing with the whole fit.
Classic Black Cat 4s.
Yeah.
And this is the Endless Summer
These
pair.
These are the Endless Summer
nice one.
Pair that people... And that you like to always mention. Yes.
Okay.
Classic hoodie.
So, somebody get us into the list. We've had so much preamble.
Yeah. Sorry. All right. Number 10. Great shoe. New Balance. Hold on. We have it listed here as the Protection Pack.
Are
we
I didn't it? Write it. I didn't write that.
Okay. New Balance Protection Pack.
Welty, please tell them it's not the Protection
it's
Pack.
It's a Refined Future.
Refined okay. Future. Please go read Welty's
New Balance Refined Future Pack or Protection, depending on how... You say it, but well, number
what is
10.
This, what is the sneaker doing on here? Because you have the biggest connection to this shoe.
It's the 2002 R, which is a shoe that came out last year, which was based off of the New Balance 2002 from like 15 years ago. But the shoe is, they kind of like tore away at the upper, you know. And they've been doing more of that recently with the same concept, which it hasn't been. As you know, groundbreaking, but the gray pair I think from this pack just looks awesome. And it was a GR shoe that sold out, and it's crazy because it's a GR New Balance that's going for like $700-800 now, which is resale value doesn't matter,
right?
But if a GR New Balance is reselling for that much money, there's obviously something to it.
Doesn't have like a hint of like teal almost in it
in the bubble, I think.
Yeah. Love that.
I think these are so cool because we've talked a lot in the past 18 months, past 2 years about. How much New Balance is doing right now that is good, and how many cool collaborations they have coming out. But this is a moment where it's a non-collab shoe. It's an inline New Balance shoe that didn't seem that special at the beginning, but was really embraced. And there were people lining up for a New Balance shoe that's not a collab. I love to see that. And a model that it's not a home run model, the 2002R. Like, no. They've had a couple collabs of it, but like people.
Salehi, like you mentioned before.
Yeah, or This Is Never That has a collab with it. But it's the model is not like a really beloved one. So to see them do that and see that reaction, it just felt like a big New Balance shoe that should be included.
And you know who had the foresight to buy that shoe and make it a moment in New York?
Who?
Our friend Bernie.
Bernie Gross, of course.
Yeah.
Extra
Bernie. Had the monopoly.
Yeah, he wanted more. He wanted the whole allocation. Should we go number 9?
Yes,
classic.
Please.
So this is the thing that I love about number 9. I was getting like texts Saturday morning like with the screen grabs from like my friends in hometown. This is like what this shoe does.
Mainstream type of shoe.
Exactly. My friend Andrew, who infamously in our, you know, I've always said in Slack, thought the Green Bean 5's upper was spray painted on. We convinced him that it was literally spray paint and not 3M.
That's one of the most random pieces of minutiae related to this.
Makes no sense, program. But we convinced him, but he sent me the Gotham screen for this shoe, always a moment. And then you look at all the old pics of MJ that went
Washington
on like the
Wizards,
IGs.
Yeah.
And you're like, this shoe is so good, so classic. Number 9.
Air Jordan 11 Cool Gray.
Oh, man. Shouts to Gentry Humphrey.
Yes.
Another pass.
Created the shoe.
Yes.
Complex Sneakers Podcast. Well,
he made
that.
It based on the Air Max 95?
No, I thought he made it. He said he just like went in.
He made it based on the Air Max 95.
Also, Ian Stonebrook, I got to shout him out.
Boardroom article?
Did you read it?
Yeah.
It was really good. Was Props good. To him.
Yeah.
The oral history of the Cool Gray 11. So shouts to Ian.
Yes. This shoe is an interesting one because we try not to just put like straight retros on these lists usually, right? Like a lot of what we consume is retro sneakers. A lot of it is old sneakers coming back out with not a lot of changes. And that's what people like a lot, right? Like they like stuff that's true to the original. And but we don't want to like give too much space to those kind of shoes. But at the same time, you can't not have the yearly Jordan 11 on here, you know, unless it's like a terrible colorway.
Like what?
Well, people got mad at me for saying the Gamma Blue is a bad Jordan 11, but...
I saw on FSR.
I stand by that. So, yeah, the Cool Gray 11, a sneaker that just means a lot. And, you know, they did some things to try and make it look just as much like the original as possible. You know, the patent leather cut is a little bit higher. We haven't had that on a retro version of the shoe, so...
When was the recent release of it? I have a dead stock pair.
2011.
Okay. Yeah. I have that. I didn't get these, but I have, like, the one of the original pairs. I remember, like, that was the... One of the first, like, oh, the yellowing of the sole. And such a great pair.
Welty, how high do you think we should allow ourselves to rank stuff that's just old stuff that came back out?
It's tough. I mean, the shoe does look pretty good. It's a shoe that I'm like, oh, those look really good, but I know I would just never wear it, you know? Like, I just can't picture myself wearing Jordan 11s.
Right.
But they do look pretty good. It's tough because it's like, yeah, it is probably the biggest, like, mainstream shoe of the year. And I feel like maybe if this was 2013 complex, like, this would be way higher, you know?
It also just released, too.
Hard to gauge those things sometimes. Yeah. But like you said, it's not a shoe that you will personally wear, but this is not necessarily about our personal opinions. It's trying to reflect somewhere between our opinion and the audience's.
Also, good piece, Jason Tatum, about the cool gray 11.
Yeah. Jason Tatum with the byline on Complex.
Yes.
Love that.
Number 8. I got these. I wore them once.
Do you like this shoe?
I do like it.
I don't like this shoe that much, to be honest with you.
Who put this on? Ben Felderstein?
All the shoes are on here by merit of, of our shared views of them.
I like this shoe. It looks crazy.
What is the shoe, Joe?
It's the Adidas Yeezy 450.
How do you feel about the Yeezy 450, Will?
I don't care about it at all.
Oh.
I just called you Well accidentally, by the way. That was a total accident. I don't know where that came from. We're not doing a good job justifying its spot on this list if none of us care about it.
This is the quintessential one-a-year Kanye new design. Uh-huh. We've seen it in the past years.
Rewarding new designs, shoes that we've never seen before.
Definitely. And I have a pair of these. I wore them maybe one day, like I said. It's just such a...
Do you have the all-black ones?
All-black.
Of course.
It's just... I'm looking at it now. Just design is like really, it's like something you haven't seen before.
Yeah.
Which we have to applaud.
It's like a claw coming up and gripping the shoe.
Yeah.
It's comfortable.
The dumplings.
Yeah, I think you have to size up, though, in them.
Is that right?
I think so. I think I sized up in them.
I didn't hear about that. But yeah, like you mentioned, like, it's important
innovation.
To highlight, new stuff, because we don't want to just come back to the same retro sneakers.
Tough shoe to wear with pants.
It's got to be tight. Right?
What, the pants have to be tight?
I think so, at the bottom, I mean.
Yeah. Okay. But Jim Jones might call you out for that.
Yes, he did in the infamous 2011.
So Adidas Yeezy 450.
Sneaker shopping.
We didn't do a great job campaigning for
I think if you go on innovation,
shoe,
new
big,
designs.
Like, I do think the Knit Runner is a better shoe. I'll just put that out there.
I like the Knit Runner more, but Welty, I think you and I were in the minority in our group discussion about which new Yeezy silhouettes belong there.
Yeah, I mean, that's the big one this year.
Which one?
The 450.
Bigger than the Knit Runner.
Yeah.
Feels like it.
I mean, the Knit Runner felt like such like more of like a, like a, I and I don't know, but it feels like they made way less of that shoe than they did the 450.
For sure. I'm sure we'll see a bunch of Knit Runners in the future, but it's still just like just getting started.
Have you guys seen a lot of 450s? I haven't out there.
No, but I see them on my timeline a lot. And that's kind of one of the gauges that we use for this stuff is like we're trying to discuss amongst each other how big these shoes are. And it's like, well, how much are you seeing them in real life? How much are you seeing them in social media?
I love that we're like, so why'd this shoe make the list? I don't fucking know.
No, I don't.
Joe did job of explaining why the Yeezy 450 is on here.
And I wasn't even on the Zoom. But I think that's
fair,
right?
It's a very scientific process that we use to determine these things.
Definitely.
And we stand by all these things.
We should have pulled a Young Bucks, and when I should have tagged you in.
I'm here. Number 7, though. I don't think we need to discuss that much why it's on the list. Definitely a shoe of the year for me. It's come up recently on this podcast.
Come up.
People.
Well, I think we should discuss this one because this is probably what I was preambling on.
Okay. We're going to discuss it. I just said that. Number 7, Comme the Garcons, Nike Air Foamposite 1. Ronnie, when we had him on the podcast, he almost had it his sneaker of the year. This also came up in Aspen. I don't want to keep saying that, but we were talking about it. definitely, a lot of people on the trip think that this is up there. So we have it at number 7.
Welty, where do you stand on this shoe?
I don't think it should have made the list at all.
Whoa.
Really?
No.
Why?
I think this shoe is very much a bubble,
like we're out of touch.
The cool guy bubble?
It's not, I don't say out of touch, it's echo chamber shoe. It's like everyone who you know who works in sneaker media thinks that this is like the best shoe.
Okay.
Well,
but I don't think that like as far as like sneakers went in, and maybe I'm off, but in 2021, I don't think that this was like one of the bigger shoes of the year.
I like it.
People who are into shoes thought it was cool that they reworked the upper and all that sort of stuff. I think the ICA Air Force One was a much bigger and more critically received shoe than the Comme des Garcons Foamposite.
Yeah, but the Foamposite is more interesting to me. Yeah. Because, well, like, the ICA...
But
like,
it's such a bigger moment in sneakers. And I'm not just saying because it's not... I'm not talking, like, black, white, dunk moment.
Sure.
But the ICA Air Force One just...
Within limited edition sneakers.
Yeah. Yeah. Encapsulated a bigger... memorable time period in 2021 sneaker culture than a Comme des Garcons Foamposite ever will.
All right, but I mean, that's fair. I love the ICA, obviously, but you know, we have it at number 7. It's not like we have it at number 3. Also, though, like, there's moments that, like, you know, you talk about the Echo Chamber. Kanye wearing them is like a moment. Like, sure. That's definitely a
that's
moment
always
that
worth something.
Yeah, that's definitely a moment that you're gonna see online and people. You know that.
I get it, but I just don't think, like, the buzz around the shoe really, like, traveled that far.
But I will say everyone
They've
who has
them...
They've
never done this to a Foamposite before.
Yeah, and everyone who has them loves them. Does that count for
Pete
something?
Pete Glock loves them. I mean, I guess one thing that I do think takes away from the shoe is that some people were upset about it being a $520 Foamposite, you know, and felt like that was not true to what the Foamposite is or, like, this sneaker.
But then,
didn't
and then like,
to
after they came
direction.
Out, they were like, not that that's always like the biggest guide of it, but they were like, like selling for under retail, even though the retail was $520.
Yeah, for sure. I do think that's it is a gauge to some extent how well they were received. But I mean, Comme des Garcons has a long history with Nike, and they get to push the boundaries in ways that others sometimes can't. And I think this was a good example of that on a classic shoe that we all love, the Foamposite. So I feel like it deserves that spot.
Same here. 2 out of 3 ain't bad. Who said that?
Where is it? Never mind. Where is that from, Joe?
Didn't Meatloaf say that?
Meatloaf?
Maybe, yeah.
2 out of 3 ain't bad? You want me to look it up?
Yeah.
Meatloaf. 2 out of 3 ain't... That's a song by the singer Meatloaf.
You guys don't know that? Before your time?
I would hit play on this, but then the lawyers would come after us. So
yeah.
Just hum it along in your head.
Okay, number 6.
Controversial pick.
Trophy room Air Jordan 1 was higher on our 2021 so far list, slipped a few spots to the end of the year list. Number 6, Trophy Room Air Jordan 1. What do you guys? We've talked about this at length.
Yeah,
great design.
I mean, here's the thing.
Great story.
Great, interesting story on so many levels.
Oh, right.
On so many levels. I feel like it's appropriate to gauge these sneakers based in part on how they are released. Because I think that these days it's not enough to just design a cool sneaker and throw it out there and let whoever snatch it up, whether it be bots or resellers or whatever. So to me, the Trophy Room Jordan 1, the story of the design of the sneaker and its connection to Trophy Room, the store run by Marcus Jordan, Michael Jordan's son, made a lot of sense. Heritage story on a Jordan 1, all-star game reference, et cetera, et cetera. The way this shoe was released was an absolute mess.
Was it released?
Released in scare quotes because reliable sources across the board have pointed to resellers getting the shoes via backdoor from Marcus Jordan. So that you can never erase from this sneaker. And because of that, you can't rank the sneaker too high. Even though it looks cool to me, even though I think it's one of the cooler looking shoes of the year, and the Jordan 1 is still a huge silhouette, maybe the biggest Air Jordan silhouette.
It could
right
have
now.
Been like the sneaker of the year if this didn't happen.
Right. But all that context around it totally degrades the sneaker and totally botches what the sneaker could have meant. And for that reason, I feel like even though in a vacuum it's quite good,
yeah,
all that stuff considered,
you don't
can't
see people wearing them that much either.
Yeah,
I think
it's also a super limited shoe, and like some of the super duper limited shoes like don't feel right to put on the top of the year end list. And so
irregardless of it being a super limited shoe, it just, like, you don't really even see it. Like, you would have thought that the Trophy Room Air Jordan 1 would be, like, the tunnel shoe of,
you
like,
see it
the
in
year.
The tunnel sometimes, though.
But not to the point where, like,
not how,
it's
as
not
as
ubiquitous as
it.
You would think it would be.
Yeah. So, fair I mean, a controversial shoe, for sure. And
a moment this year, though.
Yeah, one of the biggest sneaker stories this moment. Year.
Probably the
way.
Biggest sneaker story of the year, right? Or
no. Yeah. Bear.
Yeah, that's the biggest one.
Yeah,
when those things came,
but
back
that wasn't.
Back,
but that wasn't. Oh, I guess
that was the.
You're right,
one.
But that's not tied to a specific
right,
sneaker.
Right, it's not about a sneaker, a singular sneaker for sure. So that's where we netted out on the Trophy Room Jordan 1. I like the shoe, but I hate how the shoe was quote unquote released. So no extra points for that.
We're getting to the top 5. It's getting exciting. I can see how excited you are. Number 5. Joe Freshgoods New Balance 990 V3.
I love this.
Love it.
I love
this. Love the 3 different laces. Love the blue and the neon hints. Love the brown base.
Don't ask me. I'm colorblind. So
oh,
I
brown base.
Don't reference the colors.
Shouts to Joe Freshgoods.
Beautiful shoe.
Drop some at ComplexCon even.
Yeah, that shock drop.
Great shoe.
Best New Balance of the year?
My personal favorite New Balance of the year is the ALD.
This is the best New Balance of the year.
Okay.
993. But yeah, I think it's one of the better New Balances this year.
I wanted the shoe even higher, but there are still some people on our team who are a little hesitant to enjoy New Balance.
The person who texted you earlier
Zach
today.
The Basic is not a New Balance fan.
Who was probably arguing for like Jordan 36s to be okay, on the list.
Okay. It's hard to convince him that a New Balance can be anywhere close to the top three.
Really?
I felt like this shoe could have been a few slots higher, but other people disagreed with me. I think this is the best New Balance of the year. The colorway is great. That blue mesh looks so rich. And also, I think Joe did such a good job telling the story around it. The commercial that they rolled out with the sneaker. It was such an important moment because it really showed you how much New Balance's collaboration strategy has shifted in the past couple years. Mm-hmm. Welty, you and I have talked about this. Yeah. There was an era when New Balance was like only doing projects with like sneaker stores.
Yeah. Or like, I mean, I know they still work with them, but kind of like Todd Snyder's sort of like heritage brands.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And this was Joe Freshgoods being like, no, I'm doing my own thing on this shoe. And also I'm telling a black story through this shoe. And it was like, to me, it's such a stark contrast of like, you remember that SNL skit from a few years ago where like it's New Balance as like the white guy shoe. And this is almost
like Crazy Stupid Love.
I haven't seen the movie. You know the New Balance?
Great movie.
You know
Sorry.
The
it
SNL
sounds
sketch?
Familiar,
basically, they were like, oh,
yeah, like
yeah,
the stereotype
old,
of like
yes.
being for middle-aged white guys. And this yes. is Joe Freshgoods like sending a reminder, or sending a message of like, no, that's not just what these shoes are about. And like telling this very specific story through the shoe. I love the rollout. Joe Freshgoods got some hate for like the Chicago release and some stuff like that, how like people felt like he kind of botched it, but I still love this sneaker and I
dropped
think it's
a ComplexCon too.
This is what I would say about this sneaker also. This is a lesson in color blocking.
Yeah.
Three like different shades of brown. We see brown all the time. Like three different shades of brown. The electric blue, mm-hmm. two different green. Like there's like two or three different shades of blue, the neon green. This look at this picture. Look at a picture of this shoe. This is a lesson in color blocking. So good.
Also, like the outside clothes thing and it kind of coinciding with people being able to go back outside as the pandemic
the campaign,
settled down.
I think Mike Carson did it.
Yeah.
Just great.
Number I love this sneaker. Again, I would have ranked it higher personally, but it's not all about
shouts
me.
To Joe Freshgoods.
And don't forget where the world first saw that shoe.
Oh, on Full Size Run.
There it is.
He flashed it on the Zoom screen.
There it is.
Quick.
He knew he had one.
I don't think you really see it, but
he knew he had one.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Shouts to Joe. Congrats. Number five.
But number three in my heart.
Number three in your heart. Number four on the list. Fragment Travis Scott Air Jordan 1. Is this the high or the low?
This is the
both.
The project
okay.
as a whole.
Okay.
Both the high and the low.
The low's better.
The low is better. Welty, is the low better?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Welty,
that's definitive.
Do you like this shoe?
No.
Why is it on this list so high?
Because it's Travis Scott, but it's also like I'm not saying we also like
you're giving away the magic.
We also don't have to remember at the big like what like a 2 months ago or whatever we're like, oh, are we gonna have this argument at the end of the year where it's like gonna be is the Travis Scott Jordan the number one sneaker this year, and like we felt like we were gonna have to like have like a 3-day campaign of like
this. Let me ask you something.
I never felt like this was the sneaker of the year.
Are you do you not like this list a lot? You don't seem that excited. I'm just saying, it's not that your energy's off, but I'm just saying
I just don't care about it.
About
that,
what?
This list or
no,
this?
No.
Whoa,
like,
whoa.
No, I'm just saying. It seems like there's a lot of shoes on here where you're just like, shrug.
Yeah,
but I mean, you've always been like that.
But it's like we have to like you're not like obligated to like put these shoes on the list, but when you get to a point and you're like, how excited are you for the Travis Scott Air Jordan 1? It's like, how excited do you think I am about that shoe? Like,
are you excited? Are you excited to discuss it with your boys?
I'm pretty sure you could answer that question yourself. You know what I mean? Like,
I mean, I like the low. I think that like the
low is quite good.
I hate the
high still. Not hate. I don't like the color block.
The high doesn't do it for me as much as the low at all. Like, I think that the like kind of off-white colored sole and mm-hmm. the swoosh with the black leather around the toe box and the blue. I really like the Travis. I really like the low, I would say.
I will say that, like, this is one of those shoes where it's not high on my personal list, but the group felt like it was mm-hmm. one of the best shoes of the year. And also, I think that for our audience and just for sneakers, mm-hmm. it was one of the biggest drops of the year. Yeah, again, of not course. In terms of numbers, but just in like how much people cared about it, how much people
wanted
the shoes.
We'd look crazy if we didn't have the shoe.
Yeah.
Somewhere high on the list. Obviously, with everything that's transpired with Travis Scott, you know, it's like it.
Yeah, people dying at Astroworld definitely changed our view of the shoe because it felt like it wasn't the right time to reward a super duper hype Travis Scott product since that's connected in some tangential way to like the chaos at Astroworld. Like,
also wasn't like his most like creative shoe.
Yeah, you know?
This felt more like a. Kind of like sitting in a marketing meeting and it's like hype slam dunk, you know, rather than like, let's make a good shoe.
Yeah. Which, again, it sounds crazy that we're talking about how much we don't like the shoe or why it shouldn't be high on this list as we're discussing it. But these are our personal opinions. Because
I'm sure there's a bunch of people out there who can validate why they love their shoes so much and none of them are sitting here. So,
but again, the reason why it's high on this list was because Travis Scott's sneakers with Nike are super important. Mm-hmm. Hiroshi Fujiwara is a historically important Nike collaborator. They came together on the biggest Air Jordan right now. They relied on easy formulas, I think, but that is not enough to disqualify him from the list. And
the low, do you think the low's a good shoe?
Yeah. I like the low. Yeah. I like the low way just more than the high.
The high, ugh,
the high, I would agree rough. That the high, I think we said it before that like the color placement is a little off on the high, but the low I like.
And again, this list is composed of our opinions, the opinions of others, and also how we feel our audience respects these individuals.
Do you think there's going to be any Travis Scott shoes on the list next year, or any Travis Scott shoes next year?
I mean, I think there will be. Yeah, I think those Air Max ones will still come out. The Cactus Jack Air Max ones. That's my prediction. I have no idea. Pure speculation.
Okay. Number three.
Mm-hmm.
We touched on this earlier in the episode, but here it is officially. The Off-White Nike Dunk Low, the 50.
Yes.
Now, is this a specific model or the project as a whole?
We're taking the project as a whole.
Okay.
Yeah. We go back and forth on those type of things.
I think I had said, I thought that this was like the sneaker of the summer. Yes. Or at least like the sneaker moment of the summer.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I mean, everything this represents for Nike, for Virgil, mm-hmm. may he rest in peace, for Off-White, for how sneaker collaborations can go, for how much somebody can do. And it has this kind of sweet, poignant nature to it now.
Yeah.
Following his death, where like before that, it felt like flooding the market, or like we don't need 50 pairs, but now it's almost like
realizing how much work he was able to accomplish
in a small amount of time, mm-hmm. and this Nike swan song in a way of just giving us everything, and you know. It was important for Nike. CEO John Donahoe was talking about how this could define exclusivity at scale of making a sneaker that feels special but is still relatively widely available. The way they did it on the sneakers app, which we don't applaud the sneakers app too much,
access.
But like, yeah, the exclusive access
people,
thing. I felt
some
like
people
was
got
like,
them, yeah.
A cool thing, and I saw way more people than usual.
Wait, have you changed your mind on exclusive access or not?
A little bit. I still think exclusive access is a totally opaque way to release sneakers, but it felt good when I got the dunks, and It felt less unfair than me just trying to press a button, but we don't need to get into a deep sneakers app conversation right here.
You like Lot 1?
Lot 1 to me is way like.
Why? I like Lot 50 for the record.
You like black shoes and don't
well,
like
it
white
reminds
shoes.
Me of the,
simple enough.
Yes, but it also reminds me of the MoMA Air Force 1, mm-hmm. the black, which I missed out on. But
to me, like, there's something about the. I love how it's like that kind of like. Yellowish
sole
with the white,
a little bit vintagey.
Yeah, the black and purple to me, there's like something that screams like Adam's Family or something.
Oh, wow.
I don't know, and that's not like a shot. It's just like that, like color combo is just like not for me.
Mm-hmm.
Although there are black and purple shoes that I do like, but just on that with like the materials.
What's
and
the black and purple shoe you like?
Barclays.
Barclays, yeah.
Sure.
But yeah, that shoe not for me.
Aqua 8s also.
Aqua 8s. The shoe
Aqua
that Brendan Dunne like reenact a cult mass murder with.
Decade Low.
What? Oh, the Decade Low doesn't have any purple on it.
Doesn't?
No, the purple was the sheet that they wore.
Sorry, I mixed it up.
The SB Dunk.
I mixed it up.
That they made and canceled based on the Heaven's Gate. It had some purple in it. Also, the way that they had the 1 and the 50 and everything in between was kind of grayish and like the the motto of Off-White is like defining the space
pretty
between
awesome.
The white and the gray is Off-White. I just think these are so rich in like how you can interpret them, and me being the kind of guy who likes to do that, like I think that this is such a good package. And you know, now is the time to celebrate Virgil Abloh's mm-hmm. sneakers.
Yeah.
So I felt like for that reason, this deserved to be ranked quite high. Even though a lot of people didn't like this idea or this set of shoes when they first announced them, right?
Well, yeah, because it was just like, oh, none of the it felt like the middle or, you know, things were like, oh, how are these shoes special if they're just
a paint-by-numbers type of thing, right?
Yeah, if it's like, oh, this one has orange, but this one has green, and it's like, but I just think...
All the YouTube collections, we got 1 through 5th. There's so many videos now, 1 through 5th.
But achievement unlocked.
But to me, there's some of those I've seen that I've liked, you know, but the first one is just so good that, like...
And the last.
I can't remember which lot I have. I have one of the in-between ones, but...
Number 3, a Virgil shoe. Number 2, also a Virgil shoe. Off-white Air Jordan 2.
Great shoe.
Which color? White and red?
Yes.
Yeah, so
the other one's black and purple, right?
The other one's
black and blue.
Black and blue.
In the world I live in, blue and purple are so similar.
Everything
so
is purple.
I'm interested. I like the shoe. I have the black and blue one. Mm-hmm. I actually have the white and...
You have all of them.
Can you
be objective for once?
And say the white one's better?
Yes.
It is better.
Okay.
It is better. It is better. It has more of the classic feel, the story, and it's better, even though I would wear the black and blue one, which I have. Mm-hmm. I'm interested to see what
they... You wore them on sneaker shopping, right?
Yeah, I wore them on sneaker shopping, the Jada Kiss episode. So I... One more? Okay. So black and blue is the colorway that I prefer, but I do think from a classic and storytelling standpoint, the white, black, and red is the better one.
I mean, just the way that they redid the midsole to mm-hmm. look like it was an original Jordan 2 that had been crumbling, and it was based on something that they pulled out of the archive and did this 3D model for. Virgil's site, Public Domain, that cataloged a lot of his Nike work, had the actual 3D renderings. Just everything about it felt open source in the way that he tried to be. Him being on IG, talking about why he made the shoe look like it did. Like, to me, that's the ultimate Virgil moment.
Do we ever get any reasoning behind the colorway on the second?
I don't think so. Okay. I mean, the black and blue, I don't think so. But the other one is obviously like a very archival, Chicago Bulls type thing. Also, like the Jordan 2 as a silhouette has never been that beloved. Although for a long time, it's been the cool guy pick to be
Rich
like
Antonello's favorite.
Or like Russ Banks, that, you know, it's the, not saying that either of those people arrived at that through this, but it's like the one where
there have been a few like hype collaborations
Vashti,
there's a Dornbecker too that's pretty up there,
but those are a different era, like this kind of helped reintroduce the two. Again, like I love the moment where he's on social media explaining to people why this sneaker looks the way it does, and how much that means now after his passing.
Definitely.
No, these are really good.
Well, we've talked about it a few times, but I just remember the blue marker personal pair on his black and blue pair that he was wearing, mm-hmm. personal pair. I think I told the story. It's not a story, but I hit him. I was like, I want you to sign mine in the blue marker. Like, something about that marker, man, set off those shoes.
Yeah, it's his signature.
Yeah.
And I don't like this as much as maybe the Off-White Jordan 5 or even Off-White Jordan 1, but I think it's still a cool way for him to approach a Jordan. And it shows you, like, look at how different the Off-White Jordan 2 and the Dunk Low, the 50 look versus even the Off-White Jordan 5 or the Jordan 1. Like, it wasn't like he was just going back to the same equation. He's like, it's the same.
I feel like he was almost, like, forced to, like, put more into the Jordans because he probably knew, like, how much... I don't want to say like scrutinized, but maybe
the expectations are higher, right?
Yeah, on a classic, sure.
Totally executed with this. I love this one.
Yes,
I always have. I think it deserves to be high again. This is a time where it feels right to celebrate. Yep,
definitely. All right, drum roll. Number one sneaker of the year. People know.
Was it easy? Because I've felt like this was the sneaker of the year for 9 months now.
I feel like
there was never any.
We definitely
other
picked it early on, and we're just like, well, nothing's better than that. So it just kind of like just went with it.
They were leading a race, and they stayed in front.
We did debate these things.
Yes,
but to me, there was never any question, and I feel like a lot of people agree with this.
Number one, Ama Meniere Air Jordan 3. Sneaker of the year.
Beautiful shoe.
It came up in Slack that someone said, is this a top 5 colorway of an Air Jordan 3 ever?
A friend of ours.
You said top 3.
Top 3. Yes, top 3. Not even top 5.
Who I won't mention had said that they believed it was a top 3 Air Jordan 3 colorway, which I'm not that mad at that.
Well, that's a crazy thing to think about, how much that breaks through if it's a top 3.
Black cement, white cement, true blue.
Well, this person,
Mocha,
who will not be named,
people didn't like the Mocha.
Black cement, white cement, Ama Meniere Jordan 3.
Oh, that's good company. I brought up the mochas as well, and there was, you guys were like, yeah, whatever. But that speaks volumes.
Yes. What a clean shoe. Just the colorway kind of looks a lot like some of that pre-vintage stuff we've seen lately, but did it in a more tasteful way. There's no elephant print on it. It has suede instead, which like a lot of times would look awful, but they managed to make it look really sleek. And the liner. Well, you interviewed James Whitner about this shoe,
right? Yeah, we did it for the website. There's a video on the Complex's YouTube.
Yes, sir.
You can go watch that. It's like a 25-minute talk with him about it. And it was raised by women, the story for it. He wanted to celebrate black women, women in his life. Mm-hmm. Jordan 3s were the first shoe that his mom ever, or not first shoe, but first Air Jordan that his mom ever.
And he had that like touching like spot that introduced it to, right? Yeah. Like which James Whitner has been doing with his Jordan collaborations to kind of help tell the story around them.
I mean, everything, just the shoe was good. The story was good. Gave exclusive access to women to purchase the shoe. Yes. So I feel like, and you know, I feel like a lot, there was a lot of chatter around the shoe because obviously with James's connection to Marcus and the Trophy Room One releasing long before it and everyone was like, oh, this is just going to be Trophy Room like 2.0, right. And it was like the complete
couldn't be more separate,
and people were like, oh, this was like a moment where, like, I don't want to, I hate saying this, but like sneaker culture won.
It felt fair in a way, and like, this is our number one shoe of the year, and what I like about it is that, or one of the things I like about it is that it's a big, important shoe, but it doesn't resell for that much. Like, before the shoe released, like, people were selling early pairs for, like, $800, around $1,000 or something like that. Right now, I think you can get a pair for a couple hundred dollars, and I love that. They're like, this is
They're like $600.
Mm.
Is that right?
Yeah, they're like,
check
between,
on eBay.
They're between five and six.
Okay. Maybe
yeah,
I'm
he's
a little
right.
bit
he's
off
right.
with that. But
11 and a half, 750.
Really?
Yeah,
those are
yeah,
okay.
they're a little
okay.
Yeah.
Maybe that point doesn't stand as well, but I do remember a point where they were not reselling for that much. But regardless of the resale value, like, the way they released felt so fair, and like, to me, that's part of why we reward it, because it feels like the people who dropped this shoe, James Whitner, Amma Menier, the Whitaker Group, understood the responsibility that comes with making a hot shoe in 2021. It's not just like I said earlier, making a hot shoe and putting it out. Like, it doesn't stop at designing the sneaker.
And another one of those sneakers where everything is placed so cerebral, like the yellow, kind of like the yellowing sole, the suede is in the right spot.
The text underneath the pull tab.
Yes.
And there's so many, like, I feel like there's like hype Jordan 3s out there, you know, where it's like, in the past they've made limited edition Jordan 3s. And it's like, I feel like some of them are like pretty awful.
Like which ones?
Like a DJ Khaled Jordan 3 to me is like a pretty bad shoe.
a shoe Joe has in his collection.
Well, I mean, it's no shot of that. I just think it's an awful sneaker.
Sure, yeah, but, you're entitled to your opinion.
This is like a great shoe on a
so
great
clean.
Silhouette, you know, where it's not just the fact that it's a limited Jordan 3 is carrying this project like it has in the past for other limited edition shoes. Mm. This actually, I feel like, lives up to that.
And it's a shoe that will look good for years to come.
Yes.
Like, some of these are so flashy, you know, and we reward flashy sneakers a lot, and I think that's fine, but it's not necessarily like a sneaker that you can wear. You know, take, I don't know, a random one, Galaxy Foamposites from 2012.
Yeah,
one of
tough.
The biggest sneakers that year, and one of the ones that you would have to put high on a year-end list. But a goofy-looking sneaker at the end of the day that you're not going to regularly wear. I love the Amma Menier Jordan 3 because it's like a shoe that I wore throughout the year and I will continue to wear for the next 5-10 years.
Or even a shoe like, you know, keep it on the 3. It's like, you know, you have things like the Lotto Soulfly Jordan 3s, which that shoe, they only made like X amount of pairs. Yeah. But every time you see it, you're like, oh, that's an expensive hype shoe. It's a Jordan 3. Of course, it should be like in sneakerhead grail list. But maybe if they made as many of that design of that shoe and did it on a wider spectrum of a release, maybe it doesn't hold up to, you know, to maybe where like an Amma Menier Jordan 3 would.
Which they seem to have made a decent number of pairs, and it's still a really special sneaker to me.
Shouts to James. Shouts to the Amma Menier team. Number one sneaker of the year. Good about it.
Dude, it might have been an easy pick.
Yeah. But here's the question, though, because I know I feel like maybe this is like the end to wrap it. So we picked this as the sneaker of the year. But looking back in 5 years, do we feel like this is going to be like still the sneaker of 2021?
I think you get a Jordan 3, which is a tough assignment, and you knock it out of the park. I think that it will have staying power.
I stand by this one for sure, especially for people who were there and who understood the context in which some mm-hmm. of these things released. I think if you weren't there, and in 5 years you look back at this year and you said, wait a minute, clearly the trophy rooms were bigger because they'd go for more money, or, you know.
Or the Travis Scott. Or
yeah, like, to me, this sneaker was better designed and better executed. So I stand by that.
Okay. Listen, this has been our top 10
yeah.
of the year list.
Our meaning
our, us the group.
Sitting here, the yes. Complex Sneakers group as a
we
whole.
We're sure you guys are going to have a lot of comments. We want to know your top 10 list.
Yeah.
Put the top 10 list in the comments. I
yeah,
know,
for sure. The whole 10. And I think maybe we'll revisit a little bit more on our personal picks.
Yes.
Because we do
yes.
have... All right, should we talk about our personal favorites really quick, or should we get out of here?
I mean, I think there's a lot of... See, for me, I'll go real quick.
Okay.
But I mentioned it already. CDG, definitely on there. Not okay. putting it to... the Joun, New Balance, definitely on there. The Virgil Lot 50s, definitely on there. I mean, like, you know, I don't want to go too into it, yeah. but, like, well, yeah, the ones I mentioned at the top.
The ALD that you
ALD.
Mentioned?
I don't know. You know what? I don't know if this is, like, a top 10 sneaker of the year list, but I'm looking back at shoes that I wore that shoe a lot this year.
Mm-hmm.
Bodega 990s.
Okay.
Yeah.
I wore that a couple,
and I'm
yeah.
not, and I'm not saying that that's, like, a top 10 shoe or, yeah. like, I feel like.
One of your personal favorites, though.
In the, I guess, in the grander scheme of things, like, the Joe Freshgoods 990, because I know there was a lot of debate originally when those two shoes came out, like, so close to each other, like, mm-hmm. which one do you like more?
And Joe Freshgoods.
Yeah, I think the Joe Freshgoods is the bigger and better shoe out of the two, but I never ended up getting a yeah. pair of those, so I didn't get a chance to wear them, but I got a pair of the Bodegas, and I just mm-hmm. wore that shoe all the time. I feel like I probably would have done the same for the Joe Freshgoods shoe, yeah. so.
For me, I'm a Meniere 3, absolutely yeah. a high personal pick. Joe Freshgoods, New Balance, high up there. Eames Reebok, Friends and Family 1.
That came up a lot this week that, like, yeah. people love that shoe.
Really? Really? Yeah. On the Kiss trip?
Yep.
Okay. Carpet SB Dunk. Those are my guys.
Oh, God, it's been a long year.
My personal picks are so influenced by, like, people who mm-hmm.
Carpet
with
SB Dunk. It's been a long year.
So, wow. Stuff like that. That's, like, four. I need to figure out one more. But, yeah.
And I do agree with Joe Solomon. I've been wearing a lot of Solomon lately.
Yeah, for sure. I just don't know, like, I don't know if there's, like, one Solomon that stands out to me. I'm happy to finally be on the Solomon wave, but I there's not, like, it's hard to pick one.
Yeah. All right. That has been our 2021 Sneakers of the Year list, 1 through 10. We want to know what you guys think
Absolutely.
Is on your top 10. Feel free to put them in the comments on YouTube, on Instagram. And this has been the Complex Sneakers Podcast. We hope everyone has a great weekend.
And more than a weekend, right? Because we're going away for a couple weeks.
Are we?
I don't think we have a new episode until the new year, Joe. So
oh,
people
wow.
need to hold tight. People need to go back and watch their favorite episode
yes.
again. Maybe we'll put up... We're not going to put up bloopers. We don't really have bloopers for this show, right?
No.
What else? How else are people going to spend their time over the next couple weeks?
We'll be around. We're always around. You guys got 3 shoots today. Trust me, you'll be around.
People should spam eBay to make things happen for us in 2022, right?
eBay. You guys want us here in 2022, right? Shouts to eBay. Happy holidays. We will see you guys soon. Everyone, like, subscribe. And this has been the Complex Sneakers Podcast. See you guys soon.
Happy New Year.